The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Chapter 4, verses 14 to 21. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and the news of him spread throughout the whole region. He taught in their synagogues and was praised by all. He came to Nazareth, where he had grown up, and went, according to his custom, into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. He stood up to read and was handed a scroll of the prophet Isaiah. He unrolled the scroll and found the passage where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim a year acceptable to the Lord." Rolling up the scroll, he handed it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue looked intently at him. He said to them, "Today, this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be the Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. My dear sisters and brothers, the gospel today speaks to us about the first sermon of Jesus in Nazareth, where he had grown up, the inaugural lecture of Jesus. And Jesus prepared himself for this introductory lesson that he was waiting to give to the people. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights in the desert. And we are told he was with the Father. Alone with the Father. That's when he was tempted by Satan. It is very striking that the Son of God submitted himself to the temptations of the devil. He went through the pain of choosing between good and evil, choosing between God and Satan, a struggle all of us go through. He went through the same struggle. He knew in his heart the power of evil. The power of evil that could lead us away from God. And very categorically, he held on to his father, rejecting all the offers of Satan. We are told in the desert, the people of God were tested and they fell to the offers of Satan. Jesus, the Savior, he made a definite stand with the Father. Adam and Eve were tested. They were offered a paradise without God. Why God was the question of Satan. The question of Satan all the time down the centuries. Why God? Why obey God? I will give you a paradise without God. Adam and Eve fell for that offer. They rejected God and the paradise was lost. The paradise that was lost was to be gained back for the whole of humankind. And that's what Jesus was tested for. In his temptations, he took a definite stand in favor of God. Begone, Satan, Jesus said. It is the Father that I care for. It is the Father I will obey. It is the Father's way that I have decided to tread. He made it very clear. From there, he came down. He came down to give his inaugural lecture, the first sermon, an important sermon in Nazareth. There, he would give the very reason of his coming, the coming of the Savior to the world. It's something very striking and beautiful in this first sermon of Jesus. Jesus takes a stand, a very different stand, different from the prophets of the Old Testament, different even from the stand that St. John the Baptist took. Jesus did not speak of the wrath of God. He did not speak of the punishment of sin. He did not frighten anyone. Rather, he spoke of the good news. We are told he was handed the scroll of prophet Isaiah, and he selected a passage. Why did Jesus select a special passage? Jesus selected a special passage because Jesus had a special message to give. That special message was the good news of salvation, different from the prophecies of the Old Testament. Jesus selected Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah was a prophet who spoke about the Savior and the salvation the Savior would bring to us. Isaiah chapter 61, he quoted, he read out that prophecy. I'm sent, anointed by the Holy Spirit, to proclaim the good news, not the bad news of the anger of God, of the punishment of sin. Now, the good news. What's the good news? Liberty to captives. Recovery of sight to the blind. Freedom to the oppressed. That's the good news. A good news, Jesus continued, it is the time of the favor of God. Time of God's favor. An invitation to turn to the Lord and find our salvation in Him. My dear sisters and brothers, after Jesus read out this passage, Jesus looked at everyone sitting there. We are told the eyes of everyone were fixed on Jesus. There's a reason for this. This passage, Isaiah 61, was a very important passage for the Jews. The prophecy of salvation by the Savior. Year after year, this prophecy was read out from the pulpit of Jewish synagogues. And the Jewish rabbis, Jewish teachers, they would read out this passage and they would tell the people, God is faithful. God will send a Savior. Let us wait patiently for the salvation of the Lord. And all the people will stand up, raise their hands up and pray as we read in the Psalms. O God, send the Savior. Rain down the Savior. Let the clouds tear open and rain down the Savior. A great thirst for a salvation that the Savior would bring. But Jesus read out the passage. Jesus did not say, wait for the Savior. No. Today, in your hearing, this promise of God is come true. What did Jesus mean? Jesus was offering himself as the Savior. Now, this happened 2,000 years ago. Jesus preaching in the synagogue of Nazareth. But today, this day, when you are all come for the retreat and I am preaching to you, this is what Jesus is telling you and me, every one of us. We are conscious how sinful we are. We are conscious that we are in need of a Savior. And we know the Savior will be sent to us to set us free from the powers of evil. The Lord is offering Himself to us as our Savior. This is a day, the day we meditated on our sin. The whole day, we were listening to talks on the commandments. And we understood that we are guilty, we are sinful. But that realization that we are sinful is not a disheartening or shameful realization. It is a thirst, a waiting for a Savior. It only means the fact that I am a sinner only means I need a Savior to save me from the powers of evil. And Jesus is offering Himself to you and to me as our Savior. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My dear sisters and brothers, Let us open our heart to the salvation that Jesus brings to us, whatever the powers of sin that hold us captive, whatever could be wrong in our lives, whatever we are guilty of, every sin of our soul is an invitation to wait, to trust, to wait for the Lord, to trust in the Lord who will forgive us and lead us to the joy and glory of salvation. Jesus speaks of three types of people in the gospel today. Jesus speaks of the slaves or captives. Jesus speaks of the blind. Jesus speaks of the oppressed. Who are these three categories of people? Scripture scholars will tell us that these three words that Jesus uses are not really three categories of people. No. This is what we are. This is what you and I are. We are slaves. We are the blind. We are the oppressed. And we need to understand how we become slaves, how we become blind, how oppressed we are. When we understand these three themes that Jesus uses, we would know what is our sin and how Jesus sets us free. Slaves, you do not judge whether anyone is a slave by looking at the hands. Are there chains on my hands and feet? No. Slavery is much deeper. Slavery is in my heart. Is my heart enslaved? Is my heart so enslaved that my heart is not able to throb for God? When does that happen? That happens when we commit our sin. And Jesus said it. John chapter 8, verse 34. A sinner is a slave of sin. Praise the Lord. Shall all of us raise our hands up and say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Sin leads us to slavery. Every sinner is a slave of sin. And St. Paul tells us today of that experience of sin in Romans chapter 7, verses 15 onwards, telling us of the cross section of the heart of a sinner. What is sin? St. Paul is telling us. He said, I am able to desire to be good. I am able to decide to be good, but I'm not able to do it. I'm not able to do what I want to do. I want to be good. I want to pray. I want to love. I want to forgive. I want to be good to everyone. I want to be kind. I want to be, but I end up doing the wrong. I hate. I reject prayer. I don't care to pray. I spend time in laziness. I keep unforgiveness in my heart. Not only I keep unforgiveness, I delight in my unforgiveness. I delight in my hatred and revenge. This is what I am. And then St. Paul says, if I do what I do not want to do, then it's not I who do it, but the sin that dwells in my heart. Let us look into our own hearts. We will find this is what we are. None of us is so bad that we are determined to do the evil. No. We want to do good, but we end up doing the wrong. We are not doing it. St. Paul said, the power of sin, there are powers of sin dwelling in my heart. The power of hatred, the power of lust, the power of greed, the power of laziness, the power of unforgiveness, the power of revenge. Evil powers dwell in my heart. Why? How is it that sin becomes an evil power? Sin becomes an evil power in us because we justify sin. You know, my dear sisters and brothers, often when things go wrong with us, we blame others, right? Somebody has done some black magic against me. Somebody has sent some occult power into my life. A woman once told me, Father, my son is in Canada. A wonderful son, Father. But my son, though he's married and having two children, my son is today living with another woman, Father. That woman has done black magic against my son. Because of that power of black magic, that woman has attracted my son away from his family. My son is living with this woman. You know, my dear sisters and brothers, I understand the love of a mother. A mother is able to sympathize with a son. But the fact is, that man is living with this strange woman in an unholy relationship, not because anybody has done a black magic or occult. The power of sin, he opened his heart to. That power of lust, that power of lust, he opened his heart to. That power of lust is compelling him to do it. But the power of lust entered into him because he allowed the power of lust to enter into him. It's not anybody doing black magic. Let the whole world do black magic against me. What do I care? Jesus said, don't be afraid of Satan. Satan is a conquered enemy.